Hello, and welcome to season 4 of A Better Computer. This episode is going to be about a $200 a month web browser, but before we talk about that, I need to give a little historical context about email apps. So I've been covering tech for 15 years, and the entire time I've been doing it, people have been trying to revolutionize how we do email. Automation, elaborate tagging systems, AI features, new design layouts, turning your emails into text messages, Hey's infamous inbox. I've been there for it all. I've tried all these apps. I've talked about most of these apps on this channel. And do you know what app is in my dock on my iPhone right now for email? It's Apple Mail. Like, Apple Mail, for all of its faults, and I do find it annoying in several ways, especially as a Gmail user. I don't think it does sync very well. But the only innovation added to this app in the past 15 years is snoozing emails, and they added that about 10 years after everyone else added it. Maybe send later. I don't know, but people have been saying email is old, email's archaic, email shouldn't have to be the way it's always been. And yet basically everyone I know uses Gmail, Apple Mail, or if your job title has executive or president in it, you probably use Outlook for some godforsaken reason. I mean, in my opinion, I don't think there's been any meaningful mainstream innovations in the email space outside of snoozing since 2004 when Gmail released, and basically all at once we got a incredible selection of keyboard shortcuts, we got this idea of labels instead of folders, and maybe most meaningful of all, the idea of archiving your emails rather than deleting them as soon as you've read them because you had more than 5 megabytes of space for emails. Yes, when Gmail came out, many people had 5 megabytes of space in their email inbox. So you would get an email and delete it because even text emails would fill up your inbox quickly. So yeah, kind of crazy. So Gmail with the ability to just archive it, never think about it again, that was a big deal at the time. And I don't think anything meaningful has happened since then. And I bring this up because I want to give some historical context, which is something I'm more and more equipped to do as I get older. I guess one of the perks of aging. But these mail apps, this is an example of a category of app that seemed like it was on the precipice of changing. Technology and mobile phones and everything were going to make it better, or if not better necessarily, at least different somehow. Maybe the kids of today wouldn't know email as this inbox of things you have to read through. It would be something totally different, maybe an inbox. But today everyone just does email traditionally. Even me, like I made a video last year about Superhuman, which I think is an awesome email app. Just cards on the table, it is my favorite email app in the entire world. For me, it's the perfect app. But none of that is because of the crazy innovative things it is trying to do. It's because it's just a really good app to use. It's really quick, it's really easy, it has great keyboard shortcuts, it's very fast, it works the same on all my devices, iPhone, iPad, Mac, Android, Windows, it works great everywhere. It's not the AI features, it's not the crazy stuff that they're doing, it's just a really delightful app to use, and that helps me get through my email better. For what it's worth, I just wanted to say that I am off Superhuman and have been for quite a few months around the start of the year. I stopped using it, largely for the obvious reason. Cost, $40 a month for an email app is not worth it for me, but I wish it was free or I wish it was cheaper because I love it. But we're not here to talk about email apps. We're here to talk about web browsers. And I ended last season talking about Dia, the new browser from the browser company who are the makers of Arc, which is a browser I've talked about in this channel many times before. I love Arc. I think Arc is an awesome browser, and if you could tell, you could probably tell in that video, I was skeptical and a little spicy about Dia. Dia felt like a betrayal from the browser company. They had made something so awesome, so great that I really loved. They were moving in the right direction. And they said, we're throwing this away. We're going to start something totally new. And do you know what that idea was that made them give up on Arc? AI is going to revolutionize the browser. They had this idea that people weren't going to browse the web like they did before. AI is going to change everything. Why are you wasting your time browsing the web? Why are you going to these websites? Just have AI do it for you, right? And I bring this context of email apps, of this relentless multi-billion dollar effort from many companies to try to change email, and we still just use a stupid inbox, we archive emails, and that's really it. Like, it it hasn't changed that much, and I feel like we're going to be in a similar state with these web browsers. And Again, my skepticism in that video was pretty strong because I struggled to find real-world use cases for the AI features that they thought were so revolutionary, right? They had demos on their website and on their videos, like their very highly produced marketing videos. They had demos of people doing things, and they kind of worked okay. I just never thought I would ever do any of these in real life. And yeah, I was very sassy about it. But after that video came out, and right after I stopped recording for the summer break that I take every year, I got wind of something new, something exclusive. Apparently, the folks over at Perplexity were cooking up their own AI browser, and this was supposed to be a more advanced AI browser than anything else out there. This was Dia, but doing all the things that Dia thought it was doing already. Like, it was doing them better. And so I wanted to get in. I wanted to try it. And there was an invite list. I didn't know anyone on the invite list. So I did the thing that any good YouTuber would do, is I took the YouTube ad money I was making over the summer while I wasn't recording. I put $200 of it towards a one-month subscription to Perplexity Max. I downloaded Comet. I got it installed and set up. And I immediately turned off auto-renewal because I will not be paying for more of this. But I wanted to give this browser a try because this browser has an agent built in. And an agent in the large language model slash AI world is basically a thing that will do work for you. It will use tools for you to do things. And this will the idea of this one was basically you're looking at a website or you have a bunch of tabs open. You can open the agent and say, hey, do something on this website. And it will actually do something on the website. It'll click through. It'll write things for you. It'll do all that sort of stuff. And I'll just say it right now. I still don't get it. I think the first couple days with this browser is really thrilling as you kind of think of things for it to do and you watch it kind of do them on the web for you. And it's a really cool tech demo. It's really compelling. I appreciate if I was making videos during that time, I would have made a video a couple days in being like, this changed everything. This is blowing my mind. And I've seen YouTube videos that are like that from people who are at that state. And I'm here to tell you, 28 days into this, I think it's my subscription ends in 2 days, so I really need to make sure I record this video in time. I don't really feel it. You'll see kind of why in a second, but I'll show you a couple demos here. We'll get the app going and do our thing, but yeah, let's give it a shot and see what $200 a month for an AI web browser does for you today. And we'll have plenty of time to talk about why it doesn't really resonate with me, because it's going to be a little slow. But let's get to the demo. Okay, so here we are in Comet, and I'm in my Gmail inbox, ironically. And so I've got a number of emails here. Let's pretend I have a lot more, but just for sake of example, this is good. Selection. You want to go to the assistant, and the assistant is where you can do all sorts of things. And you can ask it to do things on this page. Now, it gets a little confused with Gmail. It thinks it's weird. So I'm going to say click through this inbox and archive any emails that aren't super important. Right? This is the thing I would do. Maybe there's a way to automate this a little bit. So what we should see in a second is a blue glow appear. There it is. Appears around the website, and you can see on the right side it's thinking about things. It's obviously like taking screenshots and going ahead and analyzing them and figuring out which ones of these are important, which ones aren't. Looks like it's decided that 9 of the 10 or 8 of the 9 are not important. It's archived them, and it should just stop right now. And I'm guessing it didn't archive the one because that one has a star in the title, which I wonder if it actually misinterprets as the star icon there. That's interesting. But okay, there we go. It archived everything that wasn't important. So, okay, that's all right. I probably could have done that just as fast, and that would be fine. But okay, let's go over here to Letterboxd, and let's have it do something a little more interesting. So let's say I want you to look up the movie. Actually, can I just look up the film Superman 2 and leave a review for it of 2 stars and say, man, the theatrical cut of this movie was not good. Maybe I'll try the director's cut later. Okay. Cool. Let's see what it does. So this is asking it to do a bit more, right? It's going to have to figure out how to search. It's going to have to figure out how to, once it's found the right movie, how to actually do something. So it's taking over the website. You can see there's no visible search field. So it's clicked on films. Oh, maybe we'll see find a film there. Oh, I found it in the menu bar this time. Okay, that's fine. That's fine. So let's see what it does. We'll probably see it type out Superman 2 and search. Okay, so it's done a search. And again, my hands are totally off the keyboard here. It's doing its own thing. So now it can see the search results. It clicked into it. Okay, looks like I already gave this a 2-star review, so that makes sense. So now let's see if it can figure out how to write a review. It's given it 2.5 stars now. Instead of the required 2, I need to adjust it back to 2 stars. Let me see the correct rating. Oh, it's selected all. That's interesting. I noticed the rating is still value 5, 2.5 stars. Let me try clicking the edit diary entry. Okay. Perfect. I can see the review dialog is open. I can say da da da. Okay, and now it's put in the review that I just gave it, so that's something. And now it should hit save. Yep, it's going to hit save. And there we go. The review is updated, and it should be done. So, yeah. Instead of writing a review, I just talked to the computer, and it made a review for me. So that's something, right? It did that. Would I ever do this in real life? Probably not. Oh, somehow it's back to a 2.5-star review. And now it sees that's an issue. And now it's doing error correction. And now it's like fixing it, right? And so this is the thing that I keep finding when I do these sorts of automations here. It's just like, yeah, I mean, I guess it did the thing, but either not always correct, or it just takes so much longer than me just doing it myself. And like, I guess there's conceivably a version of like deep research with this that could work. That's like, actually, let's try that. Let's do Superman. Let's just search Superman and let's open a bunch in tabs, right? So, let's do Superman 2, 3, 4. So now I have a bunch of Superman movies in tabs. So let's make a new assistant chat and let's say, look at all my tabs and decide which Superman movie I should watch if I want the best one. And so let's see what it does. So will it analyze all of my tabs? I don't know. I'm in the newest one, which is just open. So I don't know if it's just going to look at that, searching your browser. So it's pulling up my open tabs. So this is something similar to what Dia does. And let's see. So it's getting the full page details. So it should get the reviews. And again, it's kind of doing that, but okay. So it's looked at the review scores and said Superman 2025 is the highest average. Then Superman, then 2, 3, 4. Man, this series really just went downhill. It says watch the newest one because it has the highest rating. And then here's the ranking of lists. Like, okay, the computer did that for me, but like I can just tab through them and find these pretty quickly. So I find the usability occasionally useful, but not that practical, I guess. Let's go to Gmail again, actually, and let's see something that it should be good at. So let's actually switch over to this account. Let's go to this email. And one of the things it recommended, right, was help compose a reply. This is a newsletter, so who knows how good it'll do. But here's a whole email. So it's preparing to assist me with composing an email. And we wait. And it takes a while. And this is, again, the thing that you're going to recognize over and over again is that it can do some of these things for you, but it's just pretty slow. And I don't know. I find it a little frustrating. So even if this was super fast, I personally, okay. There you go. So there's an email that I could put in there if I want. But like all of these use cases are very contrived to me. These aren't things I would actually do. And I just, I don't know. It hasn't clicked with me yet. And maybe it's just me being old and not being into this, but like, I just don't see how I'm actually supposed to use these to get my job done in a better way, in ways that I can't already use just like ChatGPT or Claude or whatever to like do this. I'm not sure why it being built into the browser is so much better. And the examples I'm seeing from Dia and from Comet just, I don't know, man, they're just not there yet for me. So that's it for today. Thank you so much for coming back to A Better Computer, and I'll see you here next time. Bye-bye.